Hey guys, so I saw Spider-Man Far From Home this past Wednesday, and I gotta say, I had an amazing time. It was fun throughout. It had a lot of funny moments in it. The action is next level. Tom Holland brings another great performance as Spider-Man, and I really like what he did in this movie. I was looking for a more confident Spider-Man and a more mature Peter Parker, and he totally brought that, and the action in this movie is seriously next level, and the CGI sequences in this movie will blow your mind. There's an illusion sequence in this movie that I'll go into later. Probably one of the best and one of my favorite sequences in any Spider-Man movie ever. As well, Jake Gyllenhaal did an amazing job as Mysterio. Seriously, it impressed me how well he did in this movie, adapting such a kind of silly character to live action. He did it so perfectly. I was just really amazed by him. Now, is he my favorite villain? Do I think he's a better villain than Vulture? No, I'm not all the way for his motivations. I think Vulture was a better villain purely because of his motivations, but Mysterio is definitely high on the MCU villain list, and Spider-Man Far From Home just so happens to be my new favorite Spider-Man movie, which is hard because obviously there's Homecoming and there's Spider-Man 2, but just because it's my new favorite movie, just because I really enjoyed it, does not mean it's a perfect movie by any means, guys. It has a good amount of flaws to it, and I'll get into all those right now after I give you guys the quickish summary of the movie, and after those things, I'll go into all the things I absolutely loved about this movie, because there is a good amount of those too, and I'll talk about those just god tier post-credit scenes, guys. Those are probably the best post slash mid-credit scenes that I've seen in a very long time in the MCU. They were just what post-credit scenes should be, shocking, giving you excited for what's to come, not any deleted scene or just stupid thing that they cut out of the movie and was in the trailers. I really, really enjoyed this movie, and let's get right into this. So the movie picks up about 8 months after the events of Avengers Endgame. Life after the snap is addressed, and also life coming back after the Hulk snap is addressed as the blip. That actually sets up Peter's romantic rival for the movie. Peter is dealing with the death of Tony Stark and the pressure to rise to the occasion and be the world's next Iron Man level superhero, the one to take on those world-ending threats and become more than just the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man, all while trying to tell the girl he likes how he feels about her and realistically kind of just unwind. I mean, he went to space, he fought a big purple alien demigod and got his ass kicked. He died, and then he woke up and realized that he was gone for 5 years and then had to fight an army for the fate of the universe. So I can understand why he would be hesitant to take on a big Avengers level threat. But still, no matter how much he ghosts Nick Fury obviously catches up to him while he's on his summer vacation with his classmates. And this is where he meets Quentin Beck, aka Mysterio, and he gives them this whole story about these elementals that were from his universe. These elementals destroyed his world and his family, and he was the last of his kind, so he came to this world to stop him because for some reason they came to this world because of the snap. At this point, Peter resists, but Nick Fury then hijacks his field trip and takes Peter wherever he needs to go to fight these things, and they do fight these elemental monsters. Of course, they win. During this time, Peter is given these glasses that Tony Stark left for him with a note that I believe said for the next Iron Man, and has this AI in it called Edith that pretty much gives the owner all access to Stark protocols, like satellites and everything. Peter doesn't think he deserves this, and he interprets this as Tony Stark chose him to pick the next Iron Man, not for the next Iron Man, which is Peter, but the next Iron Man level hero. And Peter actually gives these glasses to Mysterio because he feels that he's just not ready for Avengers level threats, and it's revealed that Mysterio is actually a bad guy. He's from this Earth, and he's actually the developer of Barf Tech, like I had suspected all along, guys. He has a whole crew of old disgruntled Stark employees that are working with him with this ruse against Nick Fury and S.H.I.E.L.D. and Peter. They even brought some dude back from the first Iron Man movie, so that's just such a deep reach, and I love how they do that, like the Barf Tech and bringing back people from the older movies. Like, they just weave pieces of the MCU together, and I love how they do that. Like, it just makes the world feel more connected and more real, and I love those personal little touches. Mysterio's motivation is to become the next Iron Man and to make the world see what he wants them to see, and I really like Mysterio for this. I don't necessarily like the motivation of him being the next Iron Man or being perceived as the next Iron Man, because if another Thanos comes to Earth, what is he gonna do? Is a very Mysterio thing to do, but he touches on that people will believe anything now, and that's an actual thing that's happening now. You know, people will read an article headline and won't read the article, and they'll think a certain way. So it's all about how people perceive things, and I really, really like that about him. And Mysterio is trying to pull off one more big Avengers level threat, one bigger than all of of them, he's using barf tech and these old drones devised by that old disgruntled worker from the first Iron Man movie. That's how he's making these illusions so grand. While this is happening, he's planning this final shebang. Peter is, you know, dealing with his own stuff. He's trying to tell MJ how he feels, and Spider-Man is getting in the way. Once Peter realizes this, he tries to tell Nick Fury, and it was actually a trap for him by Mysterio, and Mysterio creates what I like to call the grand illusion. And this sequence, guys, is damn near immaculate, okay? Mysterio puts him through the craziest illusion. I can't even really describe it. Things are moving. He's falling through webs. It's just so much stuff that's awesome. He makes Peter see Iron Man's grave and Iron Man popping out, and there's snow globes. It's just really awesome. And at the end of that grand illusion, he makes everything look real. He projects Nick Fury to make Peter reveal who else he told about Mysterio, because he was out with MJ and he was trying to tell her how he felt about her. And we've all seen that part in the scene where she guesses that he's Spider-Man, and she was actually at the elemental battle. And during that battle, Peter webs a projector off of one of those barf tech machines, and she actually gets it. They see the hologram screen, and that's how Peter knows that Mysterio is guilty. And in this grand illusion scene after that, and then he puts him through one last illusion, then he gets hit by a train, and it's crazy. It comes out of nowhere, and Peter ends up in Norway, gets Happy to pick him up. He then gets a little pep talk from Happy, makes his own suit, and he's ready to rock again. He's going to London, where Mysterio is staging this last elemental battle where the drones are set to like the maximum level, and that's for sure gonna cause casualties. And just an epic Spider-Man battle ensues, guys, and I love this. This is probably my favorite like Spider-Man battle, and it's probably the best looking one besides Amazing Spider-Man 2, which had the best CGI, I think, still. But this battle was so awesome, guys. This is probably the most agile I've seen Spider-Man since the Amazing Spider-Man movies. It was just incredible. The red and black suit looks amazing in motion. He's kicking ass. He's webbing the drones. He's doing all sorts of stuff. And I really like, there's a moment where he actually runs out of web and he has to use his Parker intelligence, find his way out, to think his way out of it. Grabs the shield and he grabs this like thing that can detonate, and he kind of looks like Cap for a little bit. I really like that instance. It's a small instance, but it's like when Spider-Man runs out of web, he has to be more resourceful. He has to think of something else to do. He can't rely on one of the biggest parts of his arsenal. So I really like that they did that. And in the end, the spider sense is what edges Mysterio out and causes Peter to sense through the illusions, and he does defeat Mysterio. And Mysterio projects some serious illusions right now. Like at the end, you can barely tell what's real and what's not. While Peter was destroying some of the drones, the illusion of the elemental was becoming increasingly less believable. So he had them cut it down, and he said, "I'll make them see what I want them to see." And so that'll be a thing at the end. But obviously, Spider-Man defeats Mysterio. He kisses MJ very awkwardly, like any teenage kiss would be for introverted people like they are. They come back home, and Peter, at the end of the movie, takes MJ out for a date, a swinging date with realistic swinging and pretty awesome swinging. And we see not a mannequin, not hair going in the wrong direction. We see realistically what swinging with Spider-Man would look like. And it's pretty funny. And at the end, that's when we get the God-tier post-credit scenes. It kind of ends there, but we get the mid-credit scene and we get the post-credit scene. So basically, the mid-credit scene is the end of the movie. I absolutely love this mid-credit scene. To give you the gist of it for right now, because I want to talk about that a little bit later, Quentin Beck sent out a video before his death, or supposed death, and he framed Spider-Man for killing him, and he also revealed Peter's identity to the world. I just really can't wait to see how they handle this. It should be pretty fun. So that's pretty much the summary of the movie. Now let's get into all the things that I didn't like about this movie. First off, I felt like there was a lot more unnecessary things in this movie, which is why it might be my favorite movie, and I still kind of think it's the best. But I think Homecoming works better as a movie, just because the villain, of course, has a better motivation, in my opinion, and there's less unnecessary things in Homecoming. Even though I felt like there were some unnecessary villains in Homecoming, in this movie, Ned and Betty's romance, it was very funny at times, and it's a good little example of how teenage relationships actually are, but it just felt really unnecessary. And also, I did not like Aunt May and Happy being any kind of a thing. I thought that was 100% unnecessary. I would have been fine if they would not have done that. I think it would have been better if they did not do that. Now, the CGI in this movie was awesome. I really love the CGI, but I felt like, especially with a character like Spider-Man and this Spider-Man that doesn't have raised webbing, I've heard, is how they made those other two Spider-Man movies look way better, because supposedly what I heard is that red is a really hard color to CGI in motion, and the raised webbing helped to bring depth to it and make it look better in motion. So although I never really liked the raised webbing, it does help for CGI, and I love the suit in this movie, but it is very noticeable CGI, and I felt felt like they had opportunities to be practical with everything, and I would have really preferred that, but it's Spider-Man. But yeah, those are my biggest gripes with the movie. I just felt like they could have been a little bit more practical, and there were some unnecessary elements. That's pretty much it. Now for all the things that I absolutely love about Spider-Man Far From Home. So the web swinging was pretty awesome in this movie. More specifically, the traversal, like the way that Peter is going through these obstacles, like in Venice, where he's trying to stop this tower from falling. He like webs it, so reminiscent of PS4 Spider-Man when he's webbing that crane to one of those buildings. Super reminiscent of that. And at the end, he's running on a building. The action was absolutely next level. The final battle is so damn good. Spider-Man, he's just piecing apart all these drones using his wit. He flies through the illusion. He uses electric webbing to web all the BarfTech drones and uses the electrical current to short circuit all those BarfTech drones. You can see such a significant change in the confidence of this Spider-Man and how much easier this is for him and how much better he is at just fighting and being Spider-Man and throwing webs and, you know, moving. It's really, really good. Mysterio was an amazing villain. Jake Gyllenhaal did an amazing job. He adapted this character, I think, pretty much perfectly. Like, even though I don't like his motivation, it's such a comic book motivation that it's so not good that it's good for me. So I really like that. The suit is damn near immaculate. Everything about Mysterio in this movie. The nitpick is the motivation, but he was amazing. I really love Peter's arc in this movie. You get a sense of the Parker luck, you know, he's trying to do something that benefits himself and he just kind of gets shitted on and it turns on him in the worst way. Like when he's on the airplane and he has Ned make up that whole story about the perfume so he can sit next to MJ, and then the romantic rival, Brandon Davis, gets to sit with her and he has to sit with his teachers and that snoring dude. So I just really love that, and Spider-Man getting in the way of the things he wants to do, his personal life, which I just think is awesome. Although I think Ned and a lot of other characters could have probably been better used. They were all super funny and they just play off of certain kind of tropes, I guess. Today's teenagers, you know, Flash was that kid who's always live streaming, and that those are actual kids that exist. Those high school relationships that start quickly and end just as quick. Mysterio's illusions in this movie were made so good. I love that they used BarfTech and they brought that tech back to this. I always thought that Mysterio was gonna have something to do with BarfTech. I thought he was gonna steal it, but he actually developed it. That illusion sequence is so damn good, guys. And the spider sense, I love what they did with the spider sense in the movie, because that was another big deal in the first movie. Like, where's his spider sense? We saw it in Civil War, and then we saw it in Infinity War. So why wouldn't it be in this movie? And they did it perfectly, even though they call it the Peter Tingle, which I don't like, and they shouldn't call it that, but I don't mind them poking fun at something like that. Now let's get into those god tier mid slash post credit scenes. So the first one being the actual ending of the movie, in which on this big jumbo screen in New York, see the reporter that was on the jumbotron say, we have a report from the Daily Bugle. And when this mid credit scene came out, I remember what I was thinking. As soon as the reporter that came on the jumbo screen said the Daily Bugle, I got hyped. I was like, okay, confirmation, Daily Bugle exists. We're gonna get photography skills in the future, more than likely. This is awesome. We're about to see J. Jonah Jameson. And then to my, you know, to my semi surprise, because I had seen a picture of J.K. Simmons at the premiere and I was like, what is he doing there? Why is he here? I was kind of, you know, thrown through a loop a little bit. And when he came on, I was like, holy shit, this is perfect. Because J.K. Simmons, arguably after Iron Man, that is like the perfect casting, or probably the best casting ever. Honestly, he did a perfect job. And I love the way that they kind of spun it. It's no longer a newspaper organization. It's a news website, dailybugle.net. And they kind of gave it like an Alex Jones vibe, which I really like. So I don't know if people are actually going to believe what he says, or there's going to be a contingency of people that believe that Peter Parker is Spider-Man and a contingency that doesn't. And that's going to be, you know, kind of funny. But yeah, I really, really like that. God level stuff. And then the post-credits scene, which was of Nick Fury and Maria Hill in the truck, and you just see out of nowhere, they turn into Skrulls. Now Maria Hill turns into a Skrull. I don't know who it is. Has Maria Hill been a Skrull this whole entire time? I'm not too sure. That's the only thing I'm not sure of. Talos is actually the one who is Nick Fury in this movie. And Nick Fury is actually at this Kree outpost in space. Everybody's saying it's S.W.O.R.D., which if you don't know what S.W.O.R.D. is, it's basically like S.H.I.E.L.D. for outer space. It was confirmed recently that Nick Fury was Nick Fury and not Talos at the end of Avengers Endgame at the funeral. So this has only been happening recently. So I'm guessing there's something big that has been happening on the edge of Earth, or maybe Nick Fury took it upon himself to say, hey, they caught me slipping in the last movie. I'm not gonna let this happen. I have to be out here. So that's what I'm thinking that whole thing is gonna be about. These were honestly the best post-credit scenes that we've gotten in a really long time, in my opinion, guys. I remember the early days of the MCU and we would get these post-credit scenes that set up so much, that are so cool, and not just like a cut scene I like these that set up the universe, you know, like when we saw Thor's hammer at the end of the Hulk, I believe, when we saw Iron Man at the end of the Incredible Hulk, when we saw Nick Fury at the end of the first Iron Man, the end of Avengers, we saw Thanos. That is a shit your pants post-credit scene that we deserve. But yeah, guys, at the end of the day, Spider-Man Far From Home is a great Spider-Man movie. At the very least, it's just so good. But yeah, guys, Spider-Man Far From Home is definitely a step up from Spider-Man Homecoming. The action is more intense. The character arc is better. The characters are possibly even more charming in this movie. It's funnier, and it's a very Spider-Man story, which it should be. Peter is not trying to be the next Iron Man. He doesn't have to be the next Iron Man. He just has to be Spider-Man, that he can take on these Avengers level threats, all while still being a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man, which is awesome. And I think that's one of the greatest things about Spider-Man. I mean, he can literally be fighting crooks and criminals, and then the next day he could be fighting gods. Guys, with all that in mind, my rating for Spider-Man Far From Home is a solid 9 out of 10. But yeah, that's my personal opinion, guys. Let me know what you thought of the review and what you thought of the movie. Let me know about the things you liked, the things you didn't like, if you hated the movie, if there was anything that you actually liked in the movie. If you liked the movie, then let me know what were some parts you had issues with. I want to know, guys. That's pretty much it. And if you have any theories about what Spider-Man Far From Home is going to lead into, what you want to see in the sequel, definitely let me know. But yeah, guys, I had a really great time with Spider-Man Far From Home. I can't wait till it's out on 4K and Blu-ray. It's going to be pretty awesome to see that final battle and everything just in super crazy good quality. So yeah, guys, that's pretty much it. If you liked the video, leave me a thumbs up, comment down below, and if you want, subscribe. I always appreciate it. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.